Thank you all for being here today. I am joined by Vinita Gupta, the Assistant Attorney General for the Justice Department's Civil Rights Division, as well as obviously our great U.S. Attorney, Steve Dettelbach, the Mayor, and the Chief. It's good to have you all here as well. In recent days, millions of people throughout our nation have come together, bound by grief and bound by anguish, in response to the tragic deaths of Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, and Eric Garner in New York City. Now, as I announced last night, the United States Department of Justice is currently conducting an independent, thorough, fair, and expeditious federal civil rights investigation into each of these incidents. And as President Obama and I have indicated, the time has come, we think, to do even more. The tragic losses of these and far too many other Americans, including just last month the shooting death of 12-year-old Tamir Rice here in Cleveland, have really raised urgent national questions, and they have sparked an important conversation about the sense of trust that must exist between law enforcement and the communities that they serve and protect. Now, earlier this week, I traveled to Atlanta to begin a series of interactions with law enforcement, civic, community, and faith leaders aimed at restoring trust, rebuilding understanding, and fostering renewed cooperation between law enforcement and community members. Today, we convene the second in that series of vital discussions with leaders here in Cleveland, with the intention of building a constructive and inclusive national conversation. And we kick off this conversation, I believe, with an important announcement regarding a significant step forward in our effort to ensure the highest standards of policing and to foster broad outreach and engagement between police officials and Cleveland residents. After a thorough and independent review, the Department of Justice has completed its civil pattern of practice investigation into the Cleveland Division of Police. Now, that investigation spanned more than a year and a half, and it was launched in response to a series of troubling, high-profile use of force incidents, as well as by numerous public calls for a federal investigation by civic leaders, Congresswoman Marsha Fudge, and by Mayor Jackson. Since March of 2013, the Justice Department has closely examined nearly 600 use of force incidents that occurred between 2010 and 2013, including the incidents involving the use of lethal and less than lethal force. We have determined that there is reasonable cause to believe that the Cleveland Division of Public Police engages in a pattern and practice of using excessive force, and as a result of systemic deficiencies, including insufficient accountability, inadequate training and equipment, ineffective policies, and inadequate engagement in the community. Now, fortunately, today I can announce that the Department of Justice and the City of Cleveland have come together to set in motion a process that will remedy these issues in a comprehensive and in a court-enforceable manner. Now, under Mayor Jackson's leadership, the city has acknowledged that the department's findings that raise issues of importance to people really throughout this community. And together, we have agreed to a statement of principles that will lead to a court-enforceable consent decree, including an independent monitor who will oversee the implementation of sustainable reforms, assess compliance based on objective measures, and ensure that robust new policies and practices will result in more effective and constitutional policing. Now, we recognize, of course, that this process will be both difficult and it will be complex. It will demand engagement and input from the brave law enforcement officers who serve on the front lines, Cleveland residents, civic leaders, and other community stakeholders. It will require a sustained and collaborative effort toward clear, concrete objectives to build trust, to close gaps, and to forge stronger relationships. Now, we understand that the progress we seek will not come overnight, but I'm confident that the City of Cleveland and the United States Department of Justice will move forward together as committed partners. And this joint statement of principle and the eventual consent decree provide what I believe is a solid foundation for meaningful steps forward, so that we can enable all of the residents of Cleveland to have full confidence in the courageous public servants who work every day to keep them safe, and so that we can empower these dedicated women and men in blue to address persistent challenges to obtain the training and other resources that they need in order to do these jobs safely and effectively, and ultimately to become the outstanding world-class police force that this great city deserves. Now, this process continues today with this important announcement and with the roundtable discussion that I will convene this afternoon. All of the leaders here who will be a part of that conversation understand that accountability and legitimacy are essential for communities to trust their police departments and for there to be genuine collaboration between police and the citizens that they serve. As the brother of a retired police officer, I know in a very personal way how brave these public servants are. It is for their sake as well that we must seek to heal the breakdowns that we have seen. And although these issues are, as I said, complex and the problems long-standing, we have seen in city after city where we have engaged that meaningful change is possible. Meaningful, positive change is possible. There are real, practical, and concrete measures that can be taken to ensure not only that police services are delivered in a constitutional manner, but that we can promote public safety, officer safety, confidence, and collaboration, transparency, and legitimacy. Now, as you know, earlier this week, President Obama announced a series of constructive steps to help bolster the trust in and the effectiveness of the policing of our communities. These include convening a new task force to develop ways to reduce crime while building community trust, reforming how the federal government equips local law enforcement, particularly with regard to military-style equipment, and advancing the use of body-worn cameras and promoting community policing initiatives. Now, these are, to my mind, exactly the kinds of pragmatic and inclusive actions that will bring the right people together to engage in constructive national conversation. And they will complement the reinvigorated police reform work that the Justice Department's COPS Office, Civil Rights Division, and United States Attorney's Offices throughout the nation have been leading. Over the last five fiscal years, our Civil Rights Division has opened more than 20 investigations in police departments across the country, more than twice as many as were opened in the previous five fiscal years. We are currently enforcing no fewer than 15 agreements with law enforcement agencies, including 8 consent decrees, to correct unconstitutional police practices. And we have seen many times over that this model can work. Reform is underway in New Orleans, Seattle, Albuquerque, Portland, Oregon, East Haven, Connecticut, Puerto Rico, and Warren, Ohio. We are committed to moving forward together here in Cleveland and throughout the nation to spur renewed engagement, renewed trust, and renewed momentum to really translate coordinated action into meaningful results. Now, we have a great deal of work to do, but this announcement, I think, marks an important first step. I want to thank everyone who worked really so hard to make this announcement possible, including the dedicated men and women of the Civil Rights Division's Special Litigation Section, our great U.S. Attorney, Steve Dettelbach, and the men and women of his office, the Office of the Northern District of Ohio, and the City of Cleveland, your great mayor, Mayor Jackson, and a wonderful police chief that you have here as well. It is now my privilege to turn things over to the Assistant Attorney General for the Civil Rights Division, Vanita Gupta, who will provide additional details.